guys.
Good morning. I'm Marion Kelly, one of the founders of Diversity Leadership Alliance, and I am delighted to have you here this morning. We are having the Implicit Racial Bias workshop today, and I'd like to share with you just the impact of the look from my perspective. We're all providing perspectives and experiences, lived experiences, to increase knowledge, understanding, without a need to be right. It's our experience. It's our perspective. And we each have one. I know the look. I've experienced it. I see the fear in others' eyes when I approach. I hear the whispers and see the clutching of your purses and or your children. I even have attempted to mitigate the impact or shock of my presence with a verbal or friendly warning, but I shouldn't have to. I also have seen the reduction of the look, yet since that its transference has now gone to questioning of who I am, what I bring, and my legitimacy. Questioning that is very different than those of my white male friends and colleagues, as if I didn't belong. Bias appears in all of our lives. Let's work to identify ours and work on them collectively. Once again, good morning. I'm delighted to introduce a dear friend and colleague, Joanna Deshay, the Executive Director for the Diversity Leadership Alliance. Welcome, Joanna.
Thank you so much, Marion, and thank you so much for sharing your perspective and being so open and honest, and that's really what today is all about. Our series entitled Uncomfortable Conversations That Ignite Change is all about listening. Not just listening, but learning, and is a series that we created because we wanted to have conversations, not just conversations, but conversations that mattered, that meant something. And our sole desire is for people to walk away feeling like they have some valid tools that they can use to begin some healing, some soul healing, some repair. Because we know that there's a lot of emotion and a lot of rage and a lot of anxiety. And at the end of the day, we want to be that place that you can come to and get some tools. In order for true progress to be made, it's gonna take every single one of us. It's gonna take every race. It's gonna take every ethnicity, every culture, every religion, every sexual orientation, and political view. We truly are all in this together. And while DLA doesn't have all of the answers, we have this. We have this forum, we have this platform, and we want it to serve as a safe place, a community space where you can come and ask questions, where we can gather together and we can connect in a meaningful way. So today's dialogue is all about implicit racial bias. And we have two absolutely amazing panelists that you are going to hear from today that have some very unique perspectives on how they see implicit bias and how it's affecting corporations, the educational arena, and I'll introduce you to them in just a bit. But what I want to do is just take a quick minute and thank our education committee. While Marion and I get a chance to sit here and talk with you, there are so many amazing individuals who volunteer their time. Volunteer, that's free. You guys know this, right? Okay, so they volunteer their time to help run this organization. And we do not take that for granted. Our education committee, and I see some of them here. You know, we've got Tondra Richards with the University of Phoenix, Betty Thompson. We've got Jackie Starks. We've got those that are running our conference, Reed. I see Reed there. Thank you, Reed. Eloise. There are so many individuals, and even running today's show, Dr. Brent Scholar, who really makes sure everything flows like it should, is behind the scenes making sure we all look good. And for that, we are really grateful. What I want to do is I just want to share with you the series that we have going on and share with you all of the workshops that are in the series so you get an idea of what that looks like. So I'm going to just share my screen with you now and show you that. So in the series, we have all of the workshops that you see here. So we have got the one that you're in now, which is workshop number 2, Unimplicit Racial Bias. And then we move into September, where we're going to look at, excuse me, micro and macroaggressions. And that is September 24th. And then we go into our two-day conference here to be anti-racist. Then we end with privilege. Make sure you are registering early. So you'll see, what's the number? I think 360 was our registration number for today. We have got quite a few people on tap today. I wanna just set some ground rules. So I wanna just kind of share with you the rules for engagement. This is a place of respect. This is a place of kindness. This is a place where everybody's narrative, everybody's perspective matters. So I just want you guys to commit to fostering empathy. I want you to relinquish the need to be right. I want you to ask questions. I want you to be engaged and listen actively. But most of all, be respectful, be kind, and show love, okay? So that's the one thing I wanna make sure I share. I wanna just go through this very quickly because I wanna make sure that everybody knows kind of the level set, if you would. So I'm gonna take a quick sip. Bias. Sometimes I think we make the assumption that everybody knows the definition of words. And as we're doing this work, Marion and I know that sometimes we have to take a step back. We're already at kind of, you know, equity, inclusion, belonging, 200. We're at the next level. But we sometimes find that we need to step back just so we can level set and make sure that we're all kind of approaching this from the same place. So I wanted to just, I guess that's the teacher in me, right? So the teacher in me wanted to just make sure I define the term and let you know kind of just some of the things that are kind of in bias, if you would. So as defined, implicit bias is really an attitude, a stereotype, a belief or an association that affects understanding, actions and decisions. And the most important part is it does so in an unconscious way. So an unconscious state of mind. And it causes you to have some feelings about people like you saw in the look, right? People, even without saying anything, they have these feelings, right, about others just based solely on nothing more than their race, nothing more than their gender, ethnicity, age, or even their appearance. And it originates from any kind of mental association that you have from indirect or direct messaging. And you receive these messages over a lifetime. Right? So you get them from media, you get them from family, you get them from interactions. It's that whole thing about how you feel if you get bitten by a dog and you see a dog and you're like, oh my goodness, there's a dog, you know, and then you have this, you don't know why you have that association, but you do. So this is really what bias looks like. Now, why does it matter, right? It matters because it's harmful. There are harmful effects that are built into bias, and it influences decision-making in a significant way. And it unknowingly creates these separate set of rules in various systems, and it starts to stifle economic growth, and especially those kind of growths that you see in communities of colors. All of a sudden, all of the rules are not the same for all of the people involved. And it has a direct correlation and direct connection to structural inequity. But the beautiful thing about it is there's something you can do about it. Since bias is unconscious, just like it's learned, it can be unlearned. And you can really work through some things yourself to really unpack it, to identify it, and eventually unlearn it. And that's what you're doing now. So congratulations on being here this morning. We're so excited that you're starting that education journey. So, but continue that journey. A lot of you can take the Harvard Implicit Association test at implicitharvard.edu to really check on your own unconscious beliefs. You would be amazed at the results of that. So I really invite you to do that. Secondly, challenge your own biases. And lastly, hold yourself and others accountable when you do see that and you see those things kind of come to fruition. So I wanna just now introduce you to our two panelists. You'll hear from one later and you will start off with Mr. Lee, but I have had such a great pleasure getting to know these two individuals. But our first panelist is Dr. Lois Brown, and I'll do her full intro when I have her on the screen, and I'll read her full bio. But Dr. Brown is actually the Foundation Professor of English and the Director for the Center for the Study of Race and Democracy at Arizona State University. And she will be talking about implicit racial bias from an educational perspective in an educational sphere. And then next joining us is Mr. Lore Lee, and he'll actually start off today's conversation. And Lore is the director and administrative partner with the Office of Diversity and Inclusion at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. So I'm gonna go ahead and I guess we can give our air claps now. So yes, welcome to our panelists. Thank you so much. So first up, I would love to have this panel start with Mr. Lee. Laura, thank you so much for joining us. I am so excited that you are here. I will go ahead and make sure that I've got my view there so I can see ya. Excellent. I wonder if we could start with just a definition. As I define implicit bias, and of course that's the textbook definition, I would love to hear from you your definition as you see implicit bias and why you believe it's harmful.
So first off, before I get into your question, thank you, Joanna, thank you, Marion, and the rest of the DLA for having me here today. It's a pleasure. And I think I think it's important for us when we talk about implicit bias to distinguish the difference between implicit bias and from overt racism and discrimination, right? And so to your point earlier, implicit biases are those associations made by individuals in the kind of the unconscious state of mind where people, or the when people don't know that they are actually making that statement or making that association. And I think that's important to distinguish between the two, because overt racism and discrimination is, I know that I'm acting out this way, or I know that my behavior is in such a way that will be harmful to others. Implicit bias and implicit implicit racial bias is different, where it's, I'm not aware of it, I'm not aware that it's happening, but the impact on the individuals may be different from what my intent is. Yes. So, and I think all of us, none of us, no one is immune from having unconscious thoughts or these implicit biases that come out as we interact with each other and interact with others around us. But I think I'm gonna speak from the healthcare perspective, because that's the space that I live in. I think in healthcare it's harmful because it not only impacts us as colleagues as we work with each other, but it can actually impact our patients and the outcomes that they receive in the care that we provide for them. And so that's why it's important for us to be aware of our biases and how they may impact the individuals that we interact with on a daily basis.
Okay. So how would you say that it manifests itself then, when you look at kind of the corporate workspace, how do you see it manifesting itself, especially in even not just in Mayo as its own entity, but in the Minnesota general area and the communities that you work in? How do you see it manifesting itself?
I think we got to ask ourselves when we are doing those hiring interviews, right? And we always talk about the fit. And are people fit, culturally fit, or the fit? They don't quite fit our organization. They don't quite fit. What do we actually mean by that? I think that's where we got to start there and defining what fit really means. And if we simply say fit means, I just don't feel good about that person, That's one thing to check right there. Is that an implicit bias that we have about individuals that are coming out as we think about that person not being quote unquote fit for our team or for the organization? And that's one way that it plays out. I would say that plays out. The other ways are even as we have brought people on already, we think about promotional opportunities or succession plans or development plans, any of those things. I've seen and I've heard, but I've seen other people who are told, well, you know, that's not really for you. Well, how are you to tell me that program is not really for me, right? And then think again, those are some of the signs that play out when it comes to culture or implicit bias. It's the fit, it's the people getting opportunities for growth and development or not, and promotion opportunities. Those are all a couple of different ways that implicit bias may show up in the corporate organizations. But I think again, in healthcare, I think the impact is really we gotta be really careful about the impact that it has on our patients.
Yes, okay. So tell me about that. So you and I had a very interesting conversation. And what I love about Mayo is you guys do some very cutting edge things in terms of programs, both internally and how you kind of, you know, work with your external constituents. And tell me about how does it show up, especially when you're working with like medical staff? I mean, how do you advocate for your doctors and your surgeons when there's a bias or a racial issue involving a patient, for instance? How does that play out in your field?
So we do have a policy in place where we call our patient bias or misconduct policy, where we look at when a patient says, you know, I do not want to be seen by a Black doctor or a Black nurse or I only want to be seen by a physician that is white, 65, and has been at Mayo for 20 plus years, right? So I see a lot of Mayo colleagues on the call here, and that's real. We see that, we hear that in the healthcare space a lot. And so we have put in place about 2 years ago a policy around that, where if a patient or patient family member requests for a certain type of provider, we will better understand what the need is before we grant that grant that patient or family the provider that he or she has requested. So if it is, you know, I only want to see a female doctor or provider because I've been molested and as a child growing up and I'm a female patient, then those are times when we say, okay, that is warranted. But when it is, I don't want to see Black doctor or Black nurse because I just don't like them, or I just don't trust them, or you know, they're not even American, you know, those are times when we say, no, actually every single one of our employees do have the capability and the skills to care for you. And so in this time, this is the best provider that we will have for you at this time.
And Laura, I'm taken aback by that. And you know that, because when we had that conversation, because I think about even when my mom needed care, I would look at the doctors and my only question is, are you the most qualified? You know, at the end of the day, is are you the most qualified individual to perform this procedure? Are you the best qualified to, you know what I mean? I don't, if you came in and you were in a, you know, you were purple, it would be fine by me, great, as long as you were the most qualified to. So to hear that you're still encountering, you know, people that are in need, because when they come to you, they have a very specific need. So to hear that people are still, right, have those biases in place, when they're the ones that need is, I'm taken aback by that. So, but you do have a policy in place that you would advocate then for your doctors, even in case of a patient. That's wonderful.
Well, and then we also,
go ahead.
Please. Oh, I was gonna say, and then we also help leaders try to work with those individuals that have just been told, I don't want to see you because you're XYZ, to help mitigate some of that as well. But that's still in progress.
That's excellent. So what resources, I know you guys have a lot. Like I said, I'm always impressed with your employee resource groups that you have and all the programming that you do. Can you kind of share some of the tools and resources that you guys have at Mayo and some of the programming that you did kind of, and take it from the kind of killing of George Floyd and those feelings and sentiments to now? What have you guys been doing?
So you hit it right on the head. I think before George Floyd killing, we had multiple things like employee resource groups. We actually rolled out to all of our employees, but did not make it mandatory, because in healthcare, mandatory is a dangerous word. We did not make it mandatory. We did roll out unconscious bias and stereotype threat learning modules that all employees can take. And leaders can actually then assign it to their groups, make it mandatory within their groups, but not as an organization. So we have done that, and there's been several departments within Mayo that have made those two modules mandatory to their staff members. Now, since the killing of George Floyd, what we've done at Mayo Clinic is we've launched this, what we call Everybody In Conversations, as well as Everybody In Campaign and Challenge. And so the Everybody In Conversations is every Friday, we host a 1 hour long conversation around different topics of race, diversity, inclusion, equity, things like how does systemic racism impact healthcare, those type of things. The Everybody In Challenge that we've launched recently is really looking at accelerated learning in 4 weeks. And every day there's a learning, an activity that takes place that individuals can take part in. And each week is different. So the first week is focused on unconscious bias, and the breaking bias is what we called it. And what are the things about bias that we need to start to learn about and start to be aware of? The second week was focused on this idea of systemic racism and how does it show itself both inside and outside of healthcare. And the third, this week currently where you're in, is a focus on privilege, not white privilege, not male privilege, not, but privilege as a whole, because every single one of us comes to this setting with some level of privilege. And so privilege, and how do you use your privilege to empower others? And then the last week, next week, we'll be focused on how do you wield your power, your individual power, to create change in the settings that you are in. Because every single one of us can have and can influence change. And so we're going to talk through that. So that's a short, I mean, 4 weeks, very accelerated learning, very short learnings and readings that we have been rolling out to our staff.
Wonderful. Now, I know that you are a son of immigrants and you're a first generation immigrant yourself, right? Born in Thailand, and I know you grew up in the Minnesota area, and you've been in this kind of arena in terms of healthcare for what, about 20 years, would you say? In terms of, I wanted to make sure I was reading the bio correctly. Now, as an immigrant and as you're doing this work and in this space, this is something that, because I'm an immigrant myself, and so a lot of the work feels very personal, right? It feels like, you know, this is work that we do because it's meaningful to us. As you're doing this work and 4 weeks of intensive learning, that's a lot, right? That's a huge, you know, undertaking. Do you find that you receive any sort of resistance or pushback? Because I'm starting to get some sentiments from a few people, and someone said this to me, actually, yesterday, we're still talking about this. Mm-hmm. And if I had no response, because I mean, my response would not have been kind, but I really was just, yes, we're still talking. I said, have you seen what just happened in Wisconsin? Yes, we're still talking about this. So do you find that you're getting any sort of pushback or resistance as you are implementing these programs?
Yeah, well, we're still talking about this, Joanna, because these are the same issues in the 60s, in the 50s, that many of our ancestors and those that come before us, and many of you even, have faced, right, in our lifetimes. And so I think we're still talking about this because we have done nothing to address it as a system, as a society. And I think that's the important distinguishing difference is, as individuals, many of us on this call and on calls like this, as individuals, we've probably done the individual work, but as systems and as society, that's where the gap is, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think that's where the, why we are still talking about this. And to your question about pushback, we get pushback all the time. I mean, how many of you have heard about, you know, in your own work around this, well, isn't this reverse discrimination? right?
Yes.
Well, no, it's not, because if you look at your numbers, and I would venture to say that many of your organizations, if you look at your hiring numbers, you're still hiring a majority of white men. You're, most of corporate Fortune 500 companies are still run by white men. And so it's not like we're saying we're only going to hire from this point on, we're only going to hire individuals of color or women for roles that we have open. That's not the point. The point is, how do we truly set equitable processes and practices in place that everyone that comes in does have the opportunity that is granted to them, right? And so I think that's the difference. But we get pushback all the time, whether it's from frontline staff or throughout upper echelons of the organization. I think in many different organizations, I've seen that.
Do you find that there's a little bit of fear as we're going down, that groups feel like they're going to be forgotten, you know, as we're doing this work? Because I'm hearing a lot of people say, well, are we going to talk about other groups? Are we going to talk about other groups? Or are you finding that there's a little bit of fear or uncertainty about how we're going to navigate through these conversations? Are you seeing any of that internally?
Oh, yeah. I think anytime you have change, any time of change, you're going to see that resistance and fear. And we are seeing some of that fear, but we're trying to make it clear as much as we can, the intention and the work that we have laid out. And I think if we can, and also tying it back to things like our affirmative action and EEOC plans, the gaps there, that if we're working on with our affirmative action EEOC office now to look at how do we share those numbers more widely so that people can see where the gap is. Because I don't know if many of you are familiar with the AA plans, but in there you will see that there are gaps in your current representation as well as your availability in the market. And so if you look at that, that's one way to justify some of the increased work that you can do around things like diversity recruitment and pipeline building.
Okay, wonderful. Just so you all know, you can ask questions in the chat, and I know Brett was saying we do have some questions. And what we will do is we will have some time right after Laura is done presenting. We will do some quick questions and then move on to our second panelist. So you will have a chance to have us, if you have any questions, put them in the chat, and or you will be able to ask them live. So definitely write down your questions or put them in the chat, okay? And so let me ask this, Laura, and I know that I want to just go back to your bio, because I'm pulling things from your bio to make sure people know how much stuff you've actually done, which is amazing. Laura, actually, you've been with Mayo since 2018. Is that correct? So you've been with Mayo since 2018, but prior to that, you have experience in diversity and inclusion, working in the K-12 institutions, and that's a nice transition to Dr. Brown. You've been developing like multicultural curriculum, you've been working with the Native communities, and also really working on teacher development, which I thought was really awesome, and parent and family engagement. So I love that there's that component as well that you're working with. So as diversity advocates, as leaders that are really on a mission to lead in this space differently, what questions should we be asking ourselves? What questions should we be asking ourselves for this work?
Who's not in the room, right? So if we are simply, going back to the same pool, going back to the same group of people that we trust, so quote unquote trust all the time, we may be missing the perspectives that are not in the room. I always go into each situation or each meeting knowing that I do not know all the answers. I know that the answer lies somewhere in the community or in the group, right? So I think the first thing is identifying who's not in the room, looking at the data. What is our data telling us? What are the gaps that we have that may be telling a different story than what we think is telling us, right? So everything from our hiring data to our retention data to our promotional data, all those things tell us a different story. But then also going back to the qualitative stories as well. And then finally, I think thinking about power, how do we shift power? Because I think in larger institutions, so when before joining Mayo Clinic, I was the D&I leader at Children's Minnesota. And one of the things we found in that work there was when we went out to meet with nonprofit organizations that are run by or serve communities of color, one of the things we heard loud and clear from them was large organizations like yours, they show up with all this money and tell us exactly what to do without asking us what the problems are within our communities, right? And I think shifting that power from we drive the power to shifting it to the communities we're trying to collaborate with driving the power and owning the power. I think that's where we need to start thinking about and to really start to drive change in this space.
Yes, I think that power shift is essential, especially if you want to affect the system, right? And so when we look at corporate cultures and we look at how we can be more effective at changing the corporate cultures, what are maybe two things corporate organizations can do now? Quick things they can do now within their own organizations to really kind of start to invite more conversation, to really start to invite change. So what kind of authentic things could organizations and corporations be doing now?
If you're not listening to your employees, you need to start that now. Mm-hmm. I think at Mayo, what we've done is we've rolled out listening sessions at the right when your earlier question about George Floyd killing. Right after the George Floyd killings, we rolled out multiple listening sessions across the enterprise. And our top of the house leaders went to and sat down and listened to employees about what they're feeling around these issues around race and racism in the community and how that's being impacted inside of Mayo walls. And then when we got to the point where we're looking at how do we create change, same thing. We're listening to our employees who gave us some feedback about what some of the issues within our own culture and within our own walls are preventing people from moving, right? And are reasons why people are leaving Mayo Clinic. And I think that's one way to start listen to your employees, your diverse employees, make it intentional about your diverse employees to hear what their perspectives are about the culture of the organization, as well as how the things that are happening outside in the community are impacting them here inside. I think raising awareness and knowledge across the organization, whether it's training or development or however you do in your own organization, training and development, education opportunities, that's another way to start in this work as well. Wonderful. But it starts at the top. It needs all of the leadership to really be dedicated and engaged in this work.
And you know, and that is so true, Laura. Thank you so much for that. And that is what I think we forget sometimes. I think a lot of times, you know, with a lot of organizations that we see here, the work is oftentimes just relegated to the people in HR, right? Or relegated to the people that are doing, you know, the work in diversity and inclusion, and everybody else is like, hands off, I don't have to be engaged, until you start talking to the people in accounting and they're like, what, this happens in our organization? And you start talking to the people in customer service and they start sharing stories. So your comment that you made about really talking to your people, hearing what they have to say, I think is vitally important. And then engaging leadership, because oftentimes, you know, these things are happening and they're not getting, you know, the buy-in from leadership. So really, and leadership is the one that can help change the system sometimes, and that buy-in is critical. So Laura, thank you so very much. What I would love to do now, so if you'd stay with me, we're gonna go to the chat. I would love to just start to answer some of the questions. I see we've got quite a few going on, so I'm gonna ask Dr. Scholar to join me so he can help me navigate through some of the questions. Brent, good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Laura, very much, and Joanna, for leaving that really great discussion. We have some folks that are really, you know, kind of doing some comments back and forth. And you know, we have one that's talking about the Confederate statues, right, in terms of implicit bias, and are they considered implicit bias, right? So they're just in the courtyards, follow, you know, and such like that. Someone had answered, thinking that it was saying it was explicit bias because it was intentional for being there, but interested to know what the panel thinks.
Mm-hmm. So the Confederate statues that are up. So Laura and Dr. Brown, if you want to address this, I know we haven't gotten to you, or even Marion, if you all want to address the statues that we have up.
Well, I will say, I remember the first time that I encountered a Confederate statue. It was in Baltimore. And I remember walking from my conference hotel to another place where the conference was taking place and came across this. It was absolutely deserted. It was a surreal kind of encounter. Just, what is this? And as somebody who studies not just 19th century American history, but early American history, goes back to the moments where we see race being codified for reasons that support advancement, genocide, dispossession. You begin to understand that what people see impacts how they behave. So when you go back to the King Philip's War and the massacre and the fact that once a war was won, if you will, that the quote, loser's head was put on a spike and left at the entry of a village for years, this is there. What's the function of that object? And so when we think about Confederate statues, one of the most important things for us to begin to ask is, these are very basic questions. When did that appear? Who was invested in its appearance? Who's on that statue? Who's not being referenced? And why is that here? And those kind of questions get us into the context for statues. The objects that we see on our American landscape matter. They matter. Even if we take the controversial Mount Rushmore and we think about the Lakota Sioux and that as their primary sacred mountain, and we think they are still present, but now are being, quote, overseen by four white presidents who have very distinct, but still underreported, right, under historicized perspectives on race, enslavement, emigration, dispossession. So all of these things matter. So I think in terms of Confederate statues, what we know is that they serve a political purpose, right? We can also ask, where are all the statues of Frederick Douglass, Harriet Tubman, Martin Delaney, Crispus Attucks? And we know that we have one at best for any of the names I've mentioned. We have multiple, plethora. Right? So when we think about landscape, we think about what it is we see and what history it is reminding us to think about. And as busy people, we tend to see something and then take that and then move on. But if we pause and we say who, what, why, when, and where, we begin to understand that nothing is accidental. Everything is intentional. And to put something in a public space is a political act. And so for us, it is explicit. It is implicit as well. So
I would only add that from personal experience, if I see a Confederate flag hanging at the door of a cafe, that's not a place for me, right? And so let's not even talk about the statues. Let's talk about things like the flag, Confederate flag, or other things that remind us that that's not a place for me.
I must say that I'm just back from Gulfport, Biloxi, Mississippi. I spent 4 days there. And there were times where I felt very welcomed. Mm-hmm. There were other times because of the presence of a Confederate flag or the look that I didn't feel welcome. Mm-hmm. And so I think these things are very present and they matter. They matter to those who are looking at them and perhaps not the perspective that we all have for everything that we see is going to be very different based on our lived experience. And so my experience may be different from Justin Bogus experience, or Bogus, I'm not sure how you say his name, experience. But I respect his experience and hope he understands my perspective.
Thank you so much, everybody, for that. So, Laura, I have a couple of really kind of specific questions about the program that you have at Mayo that you were talking about. One of them is about your challenge dates. I guess someone's curious, like, is this like a set challenge that during a certain date, or can someone say, you know what, I'm ready to take this now, so I'm going to do it now, and then their 4-week start?
How does that work? Yeah, so it's all it's live. The sessions are live, but then it's recorded. So anybody can go back in, and even if we're on day 25, you can go back into day 1 and 2 and continue and do your own work there.
So it can be like a little synchronous, or it can be an asynchronous journey on your own. So great. Thank you very much for that clarification, so that people can develop their own programs and model the great stuff that you do over at Mayo. So thank you. And can you also then go a little bit deeper regarding that with some of the learning activities?
Sure.
You know, just a couple examples of that take place maybe on a daily basis or weekly basis.
So day one, when we talked about started with our breaking bias, what we did was we knew that part of the journey is understanding your own narrative. And so the first activity we did was an activity we called I Am From poem, poem writing and sharing. And so in that, there was a lot of people who posted that they did not realize that such a simple activity would be so hard to do, because it really started to, for them to start to look at how they were raised and the experiences that influenced who they are and shaped who they are today. So that's one activity. We show several different videos. We show the look here as well as part of our conversation about bias, but several videos around the different topics, and then are led through different reflection and question activities as well.
Great. Very quickly, I would like to ask the panel a question. I'm seeing this theme here in the chat, but I think it's very important. And this is another one that I think for me, and I've experienced this before, you know, I had someone when I was in corporate America that said, oh, you got this job because you're a person of color. And I said, oh, really? I said, do you know anything about me? And she said, well, no, I just know that we were on this mission to get a black person in here. And she's very bold about it, which is fine. And I had to remind her, well, this black person has 2 master's degrees and this job only required a bachelor's, but I guess I'm not qualified. And she said, oh, well, I didn't know that. I said, that's the problem. So the question that I see in the chat that's coming up is this idea of hiring less qualified candidates. So I see this going on. So I would love for Laura, if you could talk about that, and Dr. Brown, if we could talk about that, addressing the idea of hiring less qualified candidates just based on race.
So we're not talking about hiring less qualified. We're talking about ensuring that your qualified pool is as diverse as possible, so that you can choose from the most diverse and qualified candidates as possible. What we've seen within our own house at Mayo is that we've looked at our qualified pools all the way, so that hiring process, right? From applicants and qualified pools all the way to offers. And we've seen that it's pretty racially, ethnically, and gender diverse in terms of the qualified pool. Now, where it turns a little bit is within when it gets to the hiring manager and the actual offers, right? Now the representation of even just the pool itself is not there anymore. So I think what we're asking organizations to do is not so much don't hire the best, only hire people of color or only hire women, but we're asking people to make sure that they are ensuring that there's diversity along the process as well.
All right, excellent.
Great. That's great. I also pulled a theme that's been going on that I would like to kind of address. And I think many of us have seen it, and Marion was gracious enough to kind of type out an example of the equity versus equality versus equitable.
Correct.
There's a lot going on there about that. And I think it would be really great if maybe our panel can talk about that a little bit. like what they think those words are. And if you, there's a graphic you'd like to share, I do have a ton of them on my screen that I could share for equity and equality and justice, right? So yeah, I think, you know, what are the differences between them, and how do we reconcile them again in that same way, so that again, it's the, we're getting that the right people in the right position, right? The right people on the bus.
So it's lunchtime, in close to lunchtime in Minnesota. So I'll give you a lunch example. If I gave everyone on the call today a peanut butter jelly sandwich followed by a tall glass of milk, that is being equal, correct? Yeah, right? That's okay. Being equal. Everyone's getting the exact same thing for lunch today. What happens to those of you who are, who have nut allergies or who are lactose intolerant? You cannot have that PB&J, nor can you have that tall glass of milk. So what happens? You do not eat, you do not drink.
Right.
Is that being equal still?
Right.
So when we talk about equal, that's being equal. I'm giving exact same thing to every single person on this call today for lunch. Mm-hmm. Equitable is being considerate of what you need and meeting that need.
Right.
So that's one way to kind of paint a picture for you, if you will, about the difference between equal and equitable.
And now we're all hungry. Thank you.
So if you gave me a PB&J, I'm going to be mad, one, and I am lactose intolerant, two, so I'm going to be mad and madder. So no to no. But if we could, Dr. Brown, did you want to add anything? I know you are our scholar linguist here, so I wondered if you wanted to add anything in terms of those differences in those words.
So I go back to history, right? Many of us know about the Brown v. Board education case, right? What many of us perhaps need to know more about is that once the Supreme Court passed that ruling, made that ruling, that many states and regions decided that they would rather shut schools in across whole counties rather than provide equal education. And so I would, one book I would recommend, it's an absolute, it's just a concise, it's a beautiful distillation of some of the core histories that have basically become the architecture of segregation, of systemic racism. Carol Anderson's book entitled White Rage, right? And the chapter, you know, it came out of an op-ed project, and the chapters are like that. They are just crystals. And the way in which she describes the hoops through which individuals, legislators, would go in order to avoid equal opportunity, equal access, right? Or the ways in which they would not think about redress, right? Because Brown v. Board, that's 20th century. You go back into the 1700s, you have formerly enslaved and freeborn people of color creating schools in their homes for their community, for children in their community, because schools were segregated and they were not allowed to attend. So when we think about the histories that are attached to our conversations about equality, and Laura's example is profound, right? I mean, it just gives us the immediate example. Just because you now say, here are computers, everybody has a computer. Well, that's grand. Do you have access to Wi-Fi?
Right.
Do you have actually electricity? Do you have a safe place in which you can put this object? And also, what does it take for you to get to the place that's distributing these items? Like, so as we begin, so I think there's a humanity that we need to keep in front of us, and a curiosity again about context. So if we know that we're thinking about these terms, how do we contextualize them in the larger history of where we live, both in community, in state, in nation?
The one last thing that I'll add before we close this part of the discussion down is that there seems to also be a theme of adding others takes from a group. And so we're not taking from anything, we're adding to the pool. And we're from that pool, we will hire the most qualified candidate whether it happens to be a person of color or not. And so what we've done is expanded the pool to people who've never been in the pool before. I'm old enough to remember having segregated swimming pool days at the public pools. And it was never the same in the afternoon in the heat of the sun when I was allowed to swim. And it was never the same when the pool had not been cleaned when I was allowed to swim. It was never the same when the locker room had not been cleaned, or nor the showers in it when I was allowed to swim. Now we all can get in the pool at the same cleanliness time of the pool's opening. And so we have more people there. And so it's more inclusive and not exclusive. And we're not taking from, but we're adding to.
Excellent. Thank you so much for your responses. Laura, thank you so much for starting us off. And we are going to move on to the second part of our presentation with Dr. Lois Brown.
Sorry, please hold on for 1 second. Welcome to the joys of Zoom.
By the way, I got in.
Oh my God, where?
Columbia.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
How'd you get into that school?
How did I get into that school? Does she think I'm not smart enough? And don't bring up affirmative action. I've earned this.
So joining us for our second portion of today's implicit bias conversation is Dr. Lois Brown. Dr. Brown is the director of the Center for the Study of Race and Democracy at Arizona State University, and is also the foundation professor of English at ASU. She is a public historian and a scholar of African-American literature and culture, whose groundbreaking research reshapes our understanding of race, class, gender, faith, and place in America. The CSRD, where she serves as director, is known for its innovative and inclusive programming and community partnerships. The center facilitates powerful and informed dialogues and transformative scholarship about issues related to race, democracy, justice, and inclusion. Ladies and gentlemen, please help welcome to today's panel, Dr. Lois Brown. So we'll give you our air claps. Yay! So I am going to go ahead and, Dr. Brown, before we go into the presentation that we do have, I see some claps. Oh, good, they've got virtual claps. Wonderful. I wanted to, the video that we just showed that talked about, you know, a little bit about implicit bias, will you explain why you believe, like in that video, that implicit bias is indeed harmful?
So one of the things that's so, well, let me also echo thanks, first of all, to you, to Marion, to Joanna, to Brent, and to the entire DLA committee and organization. This is just so powerful. The work you do inspires me and so many of us at ASU, and continue to welcome the chance to be in conversation. So thank you for today. So one of the things that's, and I use the word struck or strike, one of the things that might strike us as we watch that video, which closes with a young woman being struck by glass that is shattering. Did you see the way in which the joy seeps out of her? Mm. She has this moment of jubilation, absolute, she's luminous. The hug is there, and then the question, right? So in addition to the look, there's the question, as Marion has so powerfully talked about today. So when we think about implicit bias and the harm that it gives, one of the things that I think we can take from just that snippet of a video, just so powerful in its distillation, is that implicit bias erodes joy. It steals joy. It impacts a person's joy. And we should dwell there because that's a physiological, emotional, psychological toll. So that's one way in which it creates harm. Implicit bias undermines community and partnership. You watch that hug happen, and we're watching her face over the shoulder of her friend. When she pulls back, that friendship is not the same. Trust has been challenged. A friendship that might have yielded amazing things is now in remission. So that's another consequence of implicit bias. Implicit bias also limits possibilities for investment, right? The degree to which an individual will invest in an organization, in an initiative, in a partnership, because the harm has been done, psychological, emotional, spiritual, mental. And then also implicit bias creates and imposes unnecessary labor on the person who experiences it. Marion spoke to this. I try to warn. I have a smile, I have a gesture, I have an explanation. That is energy that Marion Kelly could be putting towards so many other glorious things of his choosing. Yes. And yet he's doing this labor. So those are the ways in which implicit bias creates harm. And I would say, if we think about the people who are performing acts of implicit bias, it also, there are ramifications there too, because it suggests that perhaps you do not yet know enough. It suggests that you have not yet asked the right kinds of questions to understand the world in which you live. And so that is also suggesting that you are not asking enough questions of yourself and of history, of the contemporary moment. So that's also a way in which implicit bias is both harmful and does harm.
Okay, wow. You know, as a scholar, as a historian, as a professor of English, I know that words play a very important role kind of in shaping your understanding. So I wondered if you could explore with us just the words as we look at implicit and bias, and just kind of walk us through kind of some of the language that we can
absolutely
speak. So absolutely. I'll just kind of share that now and take us to, okay.
All right, so we can go to the first slide, or to the next slide. So the English professor in me comes out in these moments because it's always important, I think. We have so many benefits if we begin to think about words that we think we know the full definitions of, right? And the phrase like implicit bias or systemic racism, phrases like that, we're hearing them much more today. But what does it actually mean if we delve into the definitions, right? So definition here, contained in the mind without being clearly formulated. And that goes to the definitions that Joanna shared with us at the beginning of our conversation today. So the English professor in me often goes to the gorgeous Oxford English Dictionary, which gives you a historical overview of the ways in which words and their definitions have evolved over time. So if we go to this next slide.
Oh yeah, sorry, thank you.
If we go to this next slide, the word implicit also means this: entangled, entwined, folded, or twisted together. And that's I hope we can see that that's a very different set of possibilities than the first definition, which is very clinical, contained in the mind without being clearly formulated. So that's a bit, you know, that's a bit cloudy. This definition begins to hint at the ways in which thought patterns, experiences, assumptions are entangled. They're entwined, they're twisted together, and it gives us a sense of the kind of work that might be necessary to unravel bias, not just set it aside, not just to overcome it, but to unravel it, all right? And if we go to the next slide, we have another definition of implicit, and that is that it is about things that are overlapping. So now we have entangled and entwined, folded and twisting together, overlapping and involved in each other. This is like a Gordian knot, right? And if we begin to see this visually in a different way, it gives us a sense of A, the kind of projects that might be needed to begin to unravel bias and to unravel assumptions, stereotypes, lack of expectation, and it gives us, again, a new sense of the work ahead. All right, we can go to the next slide, which I think gives us a definition of bias. And this is really helpful, because when we think about bias, perhaps the traditional definitions are about preference, right? A preference for one thing over another. But there is this active understanding of bias as an inclination to lead, to incline to one side. And so for us in our world, it might be the Leaning Tower of Pisa, right, is a really good example. It's just inclining to one side. And this word, again, in this definition, gives us also a sense of how we are going to have to course correct. What it might mean to overcome implicit bias, to work through it, will actually result in a straightening, all right? Less of an inclining to one side and more of a correcting to straightening, if you will. All right, we can go to the next slide. All right, in addition to being inclining to one side, we also can see from this definition that it's a one-sided tendency or direction. So we don't want the Leaning Tower of Pisa to fall over by any means, but we can get a sense now, all right, that things tend to move. So there is this inclination, a direction. It might be something that we call a reflex, and it's going to be, or in, you know, it's a kind of muscle memory. It's an inclination to tend to one side. So this also gives us a sense of the ways in which it's important to work on this, and that it is, it's gradual. It requires effort, repeated exercise to correct. All right, we can go to the last slide, which has a bit more drama to it. So in addition to thinking about bias as an act of inclining to or towards, this last phrase, to cause to swerve, again, is a really powerful way to think about the kind of violence of bias, right? To cause to swerve in another direction, away from. And we see that in a much more elegant way in the look video that began our session today. But this is also, I think, a really visceral way to think about the implications and the acts of bias. So that, I hope that this set of slides, as we conclude this set of slides here, gives us a way to understand if we pause, and it was, you know, in some ways in keeping with our discussion about the statues, context matters, right? And when we think about implicit bias as this entanglement, as this inclination to lean, we can begin to understand the work that might be required of us, even if we don't understand yet all the steps, but the way in which we're going to measure a return to center.
That's wonderful. I love the Leaning Tower of Pisa analogy, because when we think about it, a lot of times I think people get overwhelmed because they think of the severity of the correction, right? It's like, well, I've got, you know, I've been raised in a racist household, or I've had my parents, you know, be racist their whole lives, or I've been around, you know, and so they feel like the auto correction. And you said something that's so profound to me. You said the Leaning Tower of Pisa is leaning, but it's still standing. Mm-hmm. Right, so that's really a profound thing to, you know, and it's okay, we've all got kind of our own little bend, if you would, and the correction is sometimes minor. It's not saying, you know, I love that, getting closer to center, right? It's not saying come all the way over here, that may not work for you, you may not be there yet, but get closer to center where you're just, you know, developing yourself and getting better understanding. And I think oftentimes it's because people are just not willing, right? This idea of empathy and being open and just listening and willing to get closer to center, I think is why they're stuck sort of in the place that they're at. So as we look at implicit bias, how would you say it manifests itself in different educational spheres? I mean, how do you see it? Everything from ranging from classroom to training environments and even kind of presentation type settings in corporations and organizations.
Well, I like to think that all the places in which we work and all the moments in which we are working with others are teaching and learning moments, right? So so when we think about education really broadly in the ways that your question suggests, We have some common denominators around the ways in which we think that racial bias and implicit bias manifest themselves. So for instance, if we think about the materials, or let me start first by saying, you know, as Laura suggested, one, it's a question about who's in the room,
right?
Who's in the room and who's not in the room. So that's one way to think about, what more work might I have to do based on who's not here? And what more work might I have to do because of who's here, right? And so really thinking deliberately as presenters or as participants about what we want to ask for from those who are leading, right? Or what we are responsible for providing if we are providing. So one of the things comes down to immediately is materials and sources, right? As you mentioned, right, that painful anecdote about the assumptions about your qualification. There's a movement on Twitter, it's called Cite Black Women, right? C-I-T-E, cite Black Women Scholars. So we have, you know, how do you begin to broaden our sense of who's doing the work? So thinking about whose materials are part of the presentation, which writers have you yet to credit, which organizations are doing powerful work that complements the work that you are, or the topics that you are addressing. Think about, you know, at this moment now, when we're all thinking about materials, we have our syllabi, we're all dealing with a pandemic, we're dealing with complete unrest, lots of anxiety about politics, about race, about the climate, California's on fire, you know, our families are cooped up, there is enormous, we need things to be set. And we're grateful when they are, but this is also a moment to look at our syllabi, to look at our training materials, to look at our slate of speakers and say, what else might I add, right? We don't want to create more work for ourselves in a moment of such stress, but we can create even more emancipatory moments if we begin to make changes, modest as they were, right, to what we offer. So for instance, I always think, I'm on the campaign very quietly, but not quietly anymore, that, you know, Harper Lee and To Kill a Mockingbird, that book needs to stop being taught as the definitive literature book for children 6th through 10th grade. My child has had to read that book every year, and we begin to contextualize it. We're like, okay, what picture does it paint in terms of race and justice, the white savior complex? How do we begin to understand violence, racialized violence? So let's think about, if we have to teach, for instance, To Kill a Mockingbird, what do we put around it? What do we put around it? Do we invoke Just Mercy by Bryan Stevenson? Do we begin to think about the history of lynching and do so in a way that doesn't traumatize our children, but gives them an understanding of the different kinds of operations that are in place around a novel like Harper Lee? It's also thinking about how in educational spheres, who we ask to do the work related to the materials, right? Full disclosure, I was born in England to West Indian parents, came to America, which I regarded as, you know, a set of former colonies and some additional land at age 11, thinking we need to go back to empire, but that was when I didn't know fully the work and project of empire. However, I digress. But I was in ninth grade classroom with a very in Florida, and the teacher singled me out one day, called me up after class, and said, "I really want to teach William Faulkner's Light in August." This was senior English. This was honors English, senior year, and so she called me aside and said, "I want to do this, but I want you to read the book first, and tell me if we should." I'm a senior in high school. She's the teacher. Figure it out. So I took the book, went home, and I read it. And of course, the thing that she was trying to get to was that Faulkner uses the N-word in that book. And she wanted my permission. And again, at this point, I'm still thinking, I'm English. I'm West Indian. I'm just visiting here. this is your country. You need to figure this out. But I thought to myself, I don't trust she's capable to teach this book with me in the room. I welcomed the chance to read it, went on to read all kinds of other things by Faulkner, but I took the book back to her and I said, no, not this year. And she didn't even ask why. So it wasn't even a teaching moment, but I offer that example as a way of thinking about who we put the burden on to admit certain materials, or who we go to help explain certain materials. Another example, choral concert at a school, ninth graders, some of whom are asked to come up and introduce types of songs. And we have a white chorus teacher who invites the Asian student to come up and describe the classical music, which she introduces as a most difficult and sophisticated piece. So she's coding it in all sorts of ways and says, now this student will come up and give us a description. And then of course, there is a spiritual. And she says, and now we're going to hear a spiritual. She doesn't give any of the, you know, adjectives to describe the complexity of that music. She's going to hear a spiritual, and she invites one of four in this concert, in this choir of 80, one of four children of African descent to come up and give this description. I was fit to be tied. I could barely sit still, right? And again, thinking about who is expected, that's bias. Is that implicit? Okay. Is it explicit? Yes. So thinking about who we ask to be responsible for materials, what it is that we want to analyze when we think about them, who we are citing and giving credit to, and how we're expanding our audience and our colleagues' sense of the multiple perspectives and areas of expertise, because that will go to the question about who's qualified, right? We push on those walls all the time, all right? Bring in more, cite different people.
That's so true. I so resonate with you, you know, because I always tell people that was very difficult for me. I believe it or not, the first time I ever heard the N-word was here in the U.S. because born and raised in West Africa, you know, Russian mom, Nigerian father, like we just don't speak that way. And I remember, you know, when it first happened and everyone looked at me and I went, what are we looking at? You know, and I'm looking around, they're looking at me, I'm thinking something just happened, but I'm not sure what it is. And I didn't have kind of that same visceral reaction because it's not a word I grew up with. But it's really interesting when you have all of these kind of biases that overlay, and then you have the kind of global, right, differences that come into play. People don't understand. In different parts of the world, right, there's a reaction and you know, kind of a involvement that's much different than here in the US. So those make sense. You know, I think that's wonderful. I think that when we talk about this, I love that you talked about the whole idea of more than just classroom, but just training and presentations, because that's, I think that whole idea of virtual learning right now is so big and the divide is so significant. You know, I said that on a panel I was sitting on for our school that was looking at we're gonna hand all of our students Chromebooks. And when I made the comment, what if they don't have Wi-Fi, someone started laughing. And I had to shut her down in this meeting. She said, I don't mean to laugh, but I'm just, who doesn't have Wi-Fi? And I said, so your privilege is speaking now. And she got offended. I said, no, that's your privilege speaking, because you have the luxury of picking up your phone, you know, getting on. I said, many people don't have Wi-Fi, you know? And then she says, well, there are lots of free ways to get Wi-Fi. Interesting. So we had this really, you know, and she was very, you know, and she's very confident that, you know, it's people just not trying hard enough. That's why they don't have access to, you know, to be able to homeschool. They're just not trying hard enough. And I remember leaving that call thinking, and these are the people that are making the rules. They are the ones that are administering, right, how our students will learn at home. And what they don't understand is there's a huge gap of students then that are left out of the equation, because no one is advocating for them at the table. So that was really significant. As we think about this, what would you say we are really inviting people to do in this space as we start to look at the work around implicit bias?
So I think it comes down to, I believe in the power of questions. I really do. Mm. I tell my students, I'm not as much invested in the answers you come up with. I'm interested in us spending a term together thinking about the ways in which you can develop the most illuminating, piercing, mischievous, productive, critically responsible questions. Yes. Questions. And when I say that, I don't mean that we should now, you know, we're now supporting that everybody goes out and finds a person of color and says, tell me, have you experienced bias? Because that's harm.
Right.
That's, again, unnecessary labor. But I do think when we're asked what we are encouraging people to do, I think it comes down to the question that starts with the phrase, what else? Mm-hmm. What else? What else might I need to know as I make this decision about, and then fill in the blank as it pertains to your work and project? What else might it be useful, necessary for me to know in order to make this decision? All right, where else might I go for sources, for wisdom, counsel? Who else might I seek out? And again, not with the, I'm working on this and I think you look like the people that I'm writing about, so tell me, but who else? And the Google is there for us, right? It will take us down some rabbit holes, but it gives us a lot of access to a lot of good material. And if we're responsible and thinking critically, we can begin to discern what it is we know. So the who else, what else, where else? And then also how else might I approach this question? So to your example of the laptops, yeah. Right? What else might we need to think about if we are trying to get computers to every child? And then it becomes, we're stepping out of privilege, right? That's a way of stepping out. That's a way of taking on a kind of work that will make your project, your initiative, that much better and more effective. And so I really want to underscore that when we tackle the entanglements that constitute the bias and the implicit bias, when we work to address the explicit bias, which is frightening, right? Lore's example of the flag, and it's, I'm not welcome there. Marion's description of Mississippi most recently, I'm not welcome here. I live in a state where folks can carry guns. And you pull up next to someone on the road, motorcycle, with his gun in his holster. So we're really in a place where we want to think about how we make our way through moments of explicit bias and racism. And it doesn't necessarily always require us to do direct engagement and confrontation. What we can do, however, is ask those very probing, piercing questions. So when we see footage on the television, and we see the difference between, you know, one racialized group going into a supermarket and taking paper towels. And it's called providing for themselves in the wake of devastating catastrophe, a natural disaster. And we see another group going in and coming out with paper towels. Looting is happening. So we want to ask, again, who else might I hear from on this topic? What else might I need to think about or learn about in terms of the economics of that area? How else might I begin to think about this? We really need to be active, engaged interlocutors with the material that we confront. And that goes from Confederate statues to Union monuments to what we see and hear on television. So we're asking people to keep asking questions.
That's wonderful. Yes, I think that you cannot ask enough questions. I think that you cannot, you know, I'm a lifelong learner, and I always say I ask questions after questions until I feel like I have some sense of understanding. Then I go and learn a little more and then come back and ask follow-up questions to my questions, because there's so much more that you unpack. Dr. Brown, thank you so much for your time and your perspective. I'm so grateful. Yes, you are wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. I would like to now, I know we've got some questions that are in the chat. I would like to move it to our questions, and then we're going to bring in a couple of individuals that are going to talk a little bit about our upcoming conference. So I want to just go to the chat and see if there are any questions. And again, I want to just remind everyone, I know we've been putting that in there, the rules of engagement. All perspectives are welcome. I love hearing what you guys are thinking and feeling, as long as we do so in a respectful manner and that we are ensuring that we're doing so with love and kindness, and that we are not, you know, that we're just being respectful to everyone that's both in the chat and verbally asking questions. So that is just a reminder for everyone that is on here as well. So Dr. Scholar, do we have, Brent, do we have any other questions that are, or themes of questions that we see coming up in here?
Well, we only had really kind of one question come up throughout that for us to kind of address with Dr. Brown's discussion that she did, and it came towards the beginning of your talk, I think around the PowerPoint that we had, and somebody did ask if we'd be sharing that, and I let him know, and I'll let everybody know, we will be sharing this video on our YouTube channel, so please subscribe to that, and then that's how you can see where the slides are. Now, the question was from David Parker, and he asked, he'd be interested, Dr. Brown, about your thoughts about the relationship between bias and tacit approval. So if you could maybe define what those are and then talk about those, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
So when we think about tacit approval, right, what are we again, or what are we again going to focus on, right? What does the word tacit mean? What does it mean, right? Does it suggest robust engagement? Is it more passive? Accommodation, right? So when we think about bias, and I think it's you know, we're really wrestling with this, the implicit and the explicit, right? I'm a firm believer, and certainly in the company of so many folks from Mayo, a paper cut can kill you, right? 1,000 of them can undo you. I don't believe that microaggression, I think it's aggression, right? Micro, macro, it does harm. So when we think about bias and tacit approval, again, those are phrases that get us to thinking about how much agency and and energy are we bringing to critiquing a moment, all right? When we want to engage, when we accommodate implicit bias, we are providing approval. It may be tacit. When we don't pose a question of how else might we think about or who else might we read, and you're not asking the person to say, who else do you think we can read? Engage everyone in the work of coming back to center. So that's the response I would give at that moment.
Brent, any other questions? Yeah, please.
Sorry, I'm muted. So there was another question there from Giovanna that she came up with that says, how can we address professionally when comments on reverse discrimination or implicit bias are made?
Well, here we go to the power of the question, right? If we're thinking again about, would you tell me about the history of our corporation? How is it, you know, we start to ask those questions. How is it engaged with communities of color since its inception? You know, this is a moment where we give other people who are doing the work of bias or making comments about reverse discrimination or really, you know, explosive racial explicit comments about immigrants, about different people of different faiths. Give those people work to do. Give them work to do. Say, tell me about the history of our company and the ways in which it has truly engaged with communities of color since its inception, and mean it. And they'll say, well, that doesn't matter. And you're like, oh, but you know, context matters. History matters. And this is such a great company. I'd love to know, because surely there must be some. And what you're doing is shifting the burden off you, all right? So it's rather than calling out, this is an act of reverse discrimination, you know, that's going to be a shouting fest. But when you can say, could you define for me what you think of as discrimination it'd be really helpful to hear your definition. How do you see us as a company really grappling with that? Give them work to do. And more often than not, the conversation will shut down. And hopefully now more people around you are inclined to say, that's something we should really look at. And then you engage them and say, it sounds as though it'd be really useful for us to address histories of hiring and employment here at fill in the blank company. Let's do that. Who can we ask? Who else might we ask? What other companies do the work we do, and how are they doing it? Then it gets comparative and it's not personal. And I think in this day and age where so much is so traumatic, have to keep it off our hearts. We have to, because we will suffer if we keep taking it off. So give people, give the aggressor, give the less, give the person who has not yet achieved center, right? Who's inclining, who's still entangled, give them work.
Okay, great. Thank you so much. We do have a couple more questions that have come in. So RJ Shannon, has come up with, you know, we are each responsible for our implicit bias. Can you address the role of cultural humility when working on our individual or corporate bias? And then we have one final question after that, just okay. So everybody knows.
I see Joanna's hand, and I also want to make sure that we offer this question.
Yes, I was going to say either one. So maybe if Dr. Brown, you could provide a perspective, and Laura, if you could provide a perspective as well, I would love to hear from both of you. So that's all I was going to say.
All right, Laura, please go ahead.
Well, I always come from, especially in healthcare, we come from the healthcare space, right? So cultural humility also is so important when we are interacting with our patients. Because if we go into that room, if I am interacting with a Muslim patient and I go into that room as a nurse and keep handing that patient the pills that she or he needs to take with my left hand and not realizing that the impact that has on that patient and keep wondering why that patient is a non-compliant patient and doesn't take his or her meds, right? That is because I don't have the cultural knowledge to understand that that left hand is an unclean hand in that cultural context to that patient, right? And so I go and check them off as a non-compliant patient who doesn't want to go along with. And so I think cultural humility is so important because we do, but at the same time, we do not know and cannot know everything there is to know about every single culture in the world that we may come in contact with.
And I think, again, too, there are different ways to elicit information, right? So there is the question, where are you from? It's really an aggressive question, right? It can be rooted in all kinds of things. And my story about where I'm from differs depending on the antagonism that I'm experiencing from a person, the context in which they want to know, and what I think they might do with the information, right? So for some people, I grew up in Florida. That's it. That's all you're going to get, right? Because I don't think that this is going to go into a place. But if somebody said to me, tell me about yourself, that's a much more expansive way. You know, to Laura's point, could you tell me about yourself and ways in which I can support you in the context of you getting treatment? Are there things that I can do and ensure that others do in order to make sure that you get the best care possible? Not only are you recognizing the humanity of that person, but you're also making space for them to tell you. You're also going to go do your homework. What do I need to know about this patient before I step in the room? You know, and think about how might I elicit the information without being combative and without seeming invasive. And also understanding that, you know, the details that we get can be incremental. We have to be active, attentive, careful, thoughtful, kind listeners. You have to be vigilant. People tell us all sorts of things in all sorts of ways, right? So if you are in your neighborhood and you start to see a plethora of political signs, you know, might be difficult to drive by. I say to myself, after I had that first reaction, I thought, well, I now have some information. I have some information. And that's all the work I'm going to do around those signs near my house. I have information. So that is one way in which I would respond to that question.
right. Do we have any other questions in the queue that we need to respond to? I'm looking at a couple of them. Thank you, by the way, RJ. RJ is a friend of DLA. She has been supporting us for many, many years and has served on our conference committee. So RJ, we love you. Thank you so much for the question.
Yes, thank you so much, RJ. And some people are asking about a register link and everything for upcoming events. Really quickly, those are all found on our Facebook page, Diversity Leadership Alliance. You can find all the events listed there so that you can pre-register. And we have been selling, I will call it selling out, with over 300 registrants for each one, which I know Joanna mentioned earlier, like 360. We do have a question from Cecilia, and that is about, can an act of a corporation be both implicit and explicit bias?
Dr. Brown, Laura, what do you think?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. I mean, I think actions are multi-layered, right? There's an archaeology to decisions. So it might be that the end product, like, you know, I mean, we're watching these gorgeous and really moving videos from Procter & Gamble. Yeah. Question. What else might we want to know about Procter & Gamble?
Right.
Mm-hmm. How else have they addressed issues of race across and difference, exclusion across their history? Because that leads us to a place of thinking, what else might we be asking them then to do? How else might we see the work that they can do, right? I think the moment we step into the world of corporations, we are thinking in this context of our nation, we are thinking about profit and loss, right? It is very trendy right now to be using the words diversity and inclusion, mm-hmm. right? That's the marketplace. So in thinking about, you know, again, thinking critically about what we see and hear, and we want to make sure that the actions of corporations, while they may, you know, I mean, many of them multi-billion dollar companies committing millions of dollars to inclusion and equity and diversity and social justice. And we need to keep asking, how are those projects going to be framed? For whom are they imagined to be helpful? How are the recipients becoming partners and not recipients? So we need to keep asking questions. So implicit and explicit, yes, because everybody, you know, everything is multidimensional.
And I would agree with that.
Go ahead, Laura.
I was going to say, at Mayo Clinic, we didn't hire our first Black physician until 1978. Okay. So do you then mean that before then, there were no qualified Black physicians to work at Mayo Clinic? Or was that explicit decisions that were made that kept Black physicians from working at Mayo Clinic, right? And so I would say there are both of those embedded in that particular practice and behavior that led to the not hiring a Black physician until 1978.
Laura, we must be connected at the hip, because I was going to say that, yes, there's implicit and explicit bias in the same organization, but I think there's a third entity, and those are environmental factors, political factors, and other influences that cause people to make a decision or not. And it's not about bias, it's about the external pressures. And I was going to use the example of not hiring a Black physician at Mayo Clinic until 1978. However, we called on them often to understand disease.
Yes, correct.
So we'd have them come and consult with us because they had expertise, but correct. We would not hire them. So that wasn't bias. That was leaning and giving in to the pressures that are external. And so know that there are things other than bias that affect the way that people behave and organizations behave.
Interesting. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Brent, do we have any more questions or anyone that wants to maybe ask our panelists a question live?
I don't think we have any other questions except a couple of things. I've posted a PDF of all of our dialogues that we have. So that has all the Zoom links for everybody, because people have been asking about that. If you, because the link in on the Facebook page actually is a post that I did a long time ago, but the event will be going up shortly on there. So don't worry, you can still register over 300 people. So you'll be fine for registration for that. And then we'll have some conference information coming up soon. And let me just check my other document. That was the last question that I kind of have, I think.
Wonderful. Well, if you've got any other questions, go ahead and put them in to the chat. We'll make sure we answer them later, and we'll make sure those answers are included as we post the video.
And really quickly, Joanna, I'm sorry, just one more housekeeping thing. If you scroll back through your chat, we do have the YouTube channel link posted there, our Facebook page posted there, so you can just click on those as well, everyone. So thank you so much for reminding us about all of those things. Oh, wait, we have something very interesting here. From Bruce Pope. Bruce, I'm going to ask you to unmute and talk about this just a little bit for our panelists on your implicit bias poem, Nursery Rhyme. Would you mind doing that?
I don't mind. And I just wanted to kind of share that. I was going to throw it out to the audience and not, didn't want to take up too much of your time, but let's go through it real quick. Basically, it's a nursery rhyme that I don't use anymore. And it goes, eeny, meeny, miny, mo, catch a tiger by the toe. If he hollers, let him go. Eeny, meeny, miny, mo. When is the last time you heard a tiger holler? They roar and growl. This old Southern nursery rhyme is not about tigers. My parents told this to me as a baby, and I told it to my children as babies until I got woke. We unconsciously repeat, pass on things that are wrong without even knowing that is what we are doing. And that's something I just wanted to bring up for all of us to kind of consider as we end the day.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much.
That's wonderful, Bruce. And that's the thing. And that's why the comment about the statues was so profound to me. So thank you, Dr. Brown. Thank you, Laura, for your comments. Is that there are so many things we have been passing down that were passed down to us, Bruce, just like this nursery rhyme you passed down, and we've never questioned them. We've never asked the question, well, why? Well, what does this mean? How does it affect me? What is it actually saying, doing? Is it harmful? Right? So if I perpetually read this to a child of color, right, what is that? What am I doing to them? And that is, I think, our job at this moment is to pause. Is to pause and ask the questions and just see, does it still make sense? The whole notion of something being status quo. So I love all of the questions that are being asked, even the imagery on the Aunt Jemima box. How many of you all have bought that thing and never thought once about the, I know I have, you know what I mean? And now they're looking at that going, we ought to really look at that, right? We ought to look at the images. And that is how the implicit bias is built. It is constant, right? Constantly before us, constantly in front of us, constantly around us, constantly pushed in our face, constantly in our ear. And all of a sudden, it builds some sense of normalcy. That's how the unconsciousness works. It builds some sense of normalcy that we have to challenge ourselves. Things like this nursery rhyme that Bruce posted. Thank you so much for that. Last words before we close, we've got some closing comments. I will go to Dr. Brown first, closing comments for us as we close out implicit racial bias.
I would just say it's really good to be in company, and that's really important going forward. Find the people that you can keep thinking aloud with, that you can keep framing and developing questions with. Keep eyes open, and I think keep asking who, what, where, why, and how, and really invest in context. Context matters. It reverberates. It's like throwing a stone into a pond. All those concentric circles are layers of context, and so that gives us a way to not only expand our understanding, increase our knowledge, but it also strengthens us. So that we have knowledge that we can bring, perspective we can bring to the difficult encounters that are part of our everyday lives. So keep finding good company. and keep asking really good questions.
Excellent. Thank you. Laura?
So I would say, as you continue this work, think about the equity lens. And Dr. Brown talked a little bit about this too. And I contextualize it into three different buckets: people, power, and processes. Who are the people you have at the table? Are you missing those that should be at the table? Who has the power to make decisions, and how do you shift your power? And what are the processes you use to bring in the data and also make sure that the processes are equitable to the people impacted? So those that would be what I would ask you to take away as you think about how do you start your journey in this space.
Thank you so much, and thank you. Marion, last words for us before we close out the program.
Thank you to our panelists. I really appreciate you being here and sharing your knowledge, experience with our DLA audience today. I would say to all of us that we are stronger together than we are individually, but use your individuality to change the narrative in whatever situation you find yourself. Find a way to educate. Now, not argue, but bring clarity to cloudy situations, or when something is clearly misunderstood, bring a perspective that those may have not ever thought of or had the experience of. That's how we work individually, but collectively, let's keep talking. Let's keep sharing, because these experiences, all of these experiences collectively, will change the direction in which we're going. And that's how you do systems change, and then work within the places that we live, play, and work to change those systems as well. Thank you again for coming to the conference. Christine French, my co-founder, would be smiling on us today if she were here. God rest her soul.
Yes, indeed. Thank you, Marion, so much. At this time, I would like to bring in our conference chair, one of two conference chairs, Reed, to just talk a little bit about conference. Reed, I'll go ahead and just share the screen. If you would just talk a little bit about the upcoming conference and what individuals can expect. So Reed, welcome.
Thanks so much. And again, Dr. Brown and Laura, what a great conversation. For me, it's all about sitting back and listening and digesting and keeping the conversation going. And I think if we want to keep this conversation going, one great place to do that is our annual conference. It's not the end of a conversation, it's just a deeper dive into these topics. Conference this year is going to be all virtual, which is a little bit different than our traditional downtown Sheraton approach, but it's going to be great. It'll be 2 days, October 29th and 30th, a little earlier this year. We're going to have morning sessions, breakouts, keynotes, national speakers, some local speakers, and just a lot of deep dive content that hits at uncomfortable conversations to keep igniting change and, frankly, just maintaining a little bit of discomfort so that we can grow, learn, and keep these relevant issues top of mind. Registration is at our website, diversityleadershipalliance.org. I believe we'll open up registration next week.
Monday.
Monday. So you can go to the website on Monday and purchase tickets. If you are an employer or a sponsor, please check out the sponsorship tiers, as you know, this requires you. You're all important in that effort to keep this conference alive and keep these sessions available to everyone. Turn it back over to you, Joanna and Brent, for a little bit about awards.
Thank you so much. Appreciate that. Brent, I'll go ahead and put up the award slide if you would like to maybe...
You are not sharing your screen, my dear.
I am now.
Yeah. There we go. So as we have the award slide up there, that's beautiful. Right here now, two links were given. This is the link to go directly to our award nominations. We are doing... five great awards in conjunction with our award partner, which is Arizona SHRM. We've been doing that with them for a few years, and we're really excited to be partnering with them again this year. You can see the 2019 winners. You know, we've had Edward Jones, the Girl Scouts, and then all of our individual winners that I cannot read their names because they're too tiny for me to read. But they're all there, and they're all wonderful leaders in our community. So what do I need to do? Here is my call to action to you. I need you to please nominate people. I have one nomination. Nominations are open. They will close the end of September. I think it's the 21st. Yep, the 21st. So we need nominations in categories for youth inclusion leader. That's anyone under 30 years of age. A diversity leader, right? That's going to be anybody who's over 30 years. And then we have three inclusive workplace awards, one for a community partner, which is a nonprofit organization, and then two for our corporate, which is above 250 employees and below 250 employees. So that's five really great awards that we want to give out this year, and we need your nominations in order to make it happen. Please, for my sanity and stress level, don't wait to the last minute. Because that's what makes it great when we have a really nice little friendly competition, right, to find out our great leaders. And we have so many of them out there. Even in these tough, you know, our challenging times, we still have our diversity leaders and organizations out there. So please nominate. And I will step away.
Thank you so much. And last year's leaders, I'll read that here. Nadia Mustafa from the city of Scottsdale, Lane Abbott with Edward Jones, Pat Gillum from the Sisterhood Extravaganza, Lucinda Andriani from Coconino County, and Saray Lopez with the University of Phoenix. So definitely this is a chance for you all to honor those individuals within your organizations that are doing the good work, that are fighting the good fight. And it's a chance also for you to recognize organizations that are going above and beyond in terms of the work that they are doing to really impart change, not just within their organizations, but within the community. We are so pleased to have you here. We love the work that we do, and hopefully you find value in the work that we do. This is a series that we embarked on to ensure that you know that we hear you. We see that you all are having trouble out there. We see your anger, we see your rage. And what we want to do as an organization is we want to harness all of that energy and make sure we can take it and use it in a positive way to affect change. Because just being angry, just having rage, does nothing for moving this vehicle forward. So we are the place of change, and we are humbled to be able to drive these efforts. Welcome to the change. Welcome to the movement. Please join us for the next conversation that we're going to have in September. Make sure you register and register for conference. This has been Uncomfortable Conversation That Ignites Change. With that, we bid you adieu. Have an amazing rest of your day. And Brent's going to lead us out with a video. Brent? Thank you all so much. We greatly appreciate it.
Bin Laden.
I don't look Jewish.
My English is so good.
Pretty for a dark girl.
Can't tell